Chair Lady Unobleza, dear brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen. As always, I begin in the name of God, God of Abraham, God of Moses, and of Jesus, and God of Muhammad. May peace be with them. Shabbat Shalom, and Happy New Year to our brother Joshua for the 5,772 years. They are very much advanced, as you know. That's why his presentation was much more developed than ours. We are just going to this part of things. Pax vobiscum and assalamu alaikum, which means may peace of God be with you all. And Shana Tova. First of all, thank you for inviting me to participate in this panel and for the opportunity to present the Islamic perspective on the subject of the relationship between religion and science. Along the times, one has always heard about the disagreement between religion and science and of mutual mistrust between those two perspectives. However, this was not the case during the Chinese and Islamic civilizations. In fact, in those two periods, religion and science were two sides of the same coin. And this to the extent, as suggested by the title of my presentation, that Islam in Europe, and in particular in the Iberian Peninsula and then Andalus, Al-Andalus, was responsible for the awakening of the sciences in Europe, having placed the seeds for the period of great splendor which followed in the old continent and became known as the Renaissance. Between the 5th and the 12th century, Islam created the most innovative and influential civilizations on earth between antiquity and modernity. From the perspective of Islam, which is what brings me here today, I have to say that religion encourages the search for wisdom and knowledge, so much so that our prophet said, search for knowledge even if one has to travel to China. In those times, China was very far. The Quran speaks about the universe as being full of signs of God, which have to be decoded through a rational and objective research. This is the reason why the Quran constantly says along its text for us to think and ponder about those signs of God, which contain messages for mankind, and therefore there is a priority and even incentive given by the Holy Book to scientific research. Some passages of the Quran clearly illustrate that, and I quote, for instance, Lord, increase my knowledge, chapter 20, 114. And it should be combined with the verses 3 to 5 of chapter 45, where we can read, surely in the heavens and the earth there are signs for the believers. And another verse, in our creation and the living beings scattered and which move around, there are signs for those who believe. And finally, and in the alternation of night and day, and in sustenance which God sends down from the skies, and with which gives life to earth after his death, and also in the distribution of winds, in all this there are signs for people who understand. But the Quran does not only say that science is important, it also indicates the methodology to pursue it, giving due importance to observation when it says, man should observe what he was created from. Chapter 86, verse 5. In other passages, for instance, and the sky was elevated, and in the mountains how they were rooted with firmness, and how the earth is scattered. But it also emphasizes the importance of measure and calculation when it says that all was created in due measure and proportion. And also, he made of the sun luminosity, and for the moon he determined phases, emphasizing the scientific fact that the sun is incandescent and a source of energy, inclusive of light and heat, while the moon, on the contrary, reflects the light received from the sun, appearing us as lighted. You can see some of the names of scientists at that time: mathematicians, physics, chemists, opticians, physicians, philosophers, and so on, who were here or under the influence of Islamic civilization. What I would like to mention, one, for instance, which was very interesting, is that it was the name of Abbas ibn Firnas, who 600 years before Leonardo da Vinci created something similar to fly. The Quran also gives great importance to technology. Chapter 57 in the Holy Quran, the title is Iron, and which metaphorically means technology, as God says in verse 25, that he sent iron which has much strength and benefits for men. The Prophet of Islam, as you all know, was illiterate, emphasized the fact that the material world can only be understood with scientific knowledge, and this is to the extent of considering Islamic culture as a culture based on knowledge. To get an idea of the importance of knowledge in Islam, it suffices to refer that our Prophet, in certain moment in time, said, 1 hour of study of nature is better than 1 year of prayers. It is interesting to note that today the Alliance of Civilizations initiative of the United Nations is, after all, recreating the spirit of Cordoba, where there was harmony among the citizens of different ethnicity and religion, fully integrated in the society, where they lived and worked side by side without any antagonism and with only one objective: the search for knowledge for the good of humanity. This was the spirit which prevailed at the time, which left the well-known Judeo-Christian Islamic, and not just Judeo-Christian, heritage for the period of Renaissance. As already mentioned, the search for knowledge is closely linked with religion and contemplation of the divine creation, which Quran is constantly reminding us of. There was therefore the need to translate important works from Greek, Sanskrit, and Farsi to Arabic, but they did not limit themselves to translating those works and copying that knowledge. They went further, discovering new principles and methods. For example, there was detailed critical analytical work of the Greek philosophy. There was also a lot of work in the empiric study of nature. This demonstrates, and I repeat, that the traditional antagonism between religion and science has no support and had no support in Islam. In the Quran, it is said that search of science should be seen as a way to contemplate unity of God. Even the concept of adoration, which in Arabic is ibadah, is closely linked to the concept of knowledge, which in Arabic is ilm, both being a form of listening to God. But it's also important to emphasize that knowledge and science should have as the only objective the search for truth and the attainment of well-being for mankind and to promote social justice. As human beings, scientists are not independent from God, but responsible towards God for their activities in the field of science and technology. It is also important to note that men, scientists or not, are responsible for the maintenance and conservation of nature and God's creation. In this context, it should be remembered that if it was precisely 1,300 years ago that Muslims arrived in the peninsula, and therefore it was precisely where we are now, in the then Andalus, that a great period of grandeur and glory of Islam took place between the 8th and 12th centuries, with considerable research and discoveries achieved in the Islamic universities, highlighting the cultural centers which were founded at the time. In that period, Jews, Christians, and Muslims worked together side by side without any discrimination based in their different faiths in promoting Greek, Indian, and Persian sciences, to the extent that many foreigners were attracted to come to Cordoba, which was then a center of excellence to acquire knowledge. One can quote the case of search of, for knowledge and critical work and of perfecting of the Greek heritage and its assimilation to the specific problems of that new reality. Sorry. Therefore, there were wise men, scholars and academics like Al-Kindi, Al-Farabi, Ibn Sina, Ibn Tufail, Ibn Rushd, known as Averroes to all of us, who worked intensely and in detail critic to the Greek philosophy. At the same time, great attention was given to the empirical study of nature with the initiation by the Islamic civilization of the experimental science as we know them today. The only scientific method resulted from works done by scientists like Jabir al-Hayyan, who was a Christian, launched the basis of chemistry at the end of 8th century of Islamic era. Ibn al-Haytham, who established the basis of optics as an experimental science in the 10th century of Islamic era. From astronomy to zoology, there was practically no branch of science in which Islamic era scientists did not work intensely, giving original contributions. The nature and extension of scientific research in the so-called golden era of Islam left important footprints of its splendor, not only through scientific libraries, universities, and hospitals, which formed an important legacy for the future generations, but also scientific instruments for observation, as the case of astronomical instruments, celestial globes, astrolabes, etc. Among the observatories spread along the Muslim world, the most influential was founded by the famous astronomer Nasir al-Din al-Tusi, who worked in Malaga in Azerbaijan and helped Copernicus to formulate the heliocentric theory. Allow me to remind you that it was with the assistance of Muslim geographers and navigators that the Portuguese explorers crossed the Atlantic and went past the Cape of Good Hope, and paradoxically, with that assistance, put an end to the Islamic dominion of the Indian Ocean. The most famous library was the one in Baghdad, known by the name of House of Wisdom, founded by the Abbasid Caliph Al-Ma'mun, who had a most important role in spreading knowledge in the Islamic Empire. In Spain, the library, which was named after Caliph Hakam II of Cordoba, had a collection of 400,000 books. And similar libraries also existed in Cairo, Damascus, and such remote places as Samarkand and Bukhara. The first university in the world was established in Cairo, the well-known Al-Azhar University. Later, there were other universities in cities like Fez and Timbuktu. Also, there were hospitals where treatment was given free of charge, and there were also institutions for practical training, as well as for theoretical and empirical research. There are the cases of hospitals in Abodi in Baghdad and Kabir al-Nuri in Damascus, which became reputable in the world for their works in research. Many surgical instruments still in use today were developed by the Muslim doctors. These are the evolution of numbers, as you know, as they are today. I don't think we can imagine doing sums and calculations in Roman numbers. It's important to note that that represented the splendor of Islamic era, also known as the miracle of the Arab culture, is in contrast with the present status of science and technology in contemporary Islamic worlds. However, the cause of this decline is not within the scope of my speech. Before finishing, I would like to emphasize that although the Quran contains answers to many doubts of the believers and has in fact a multidimensional treasure of knowledge which enriches us all, it does not, however, have detailed information on different branches of science, containing only the basic principles, but strongly encouraging the believer to search for further answers. The Quran obviously is not a book of science and does not cover themes like physics, chemistry, or mathematics. The scientific facts naturally are only mentioned in general terms and without entering into details. As it's often referred, the Quran does not only give mankind the fish to eat, but teaches mankind how to fish. This is the medieval Arab gate for the fortress of knowledge. I consider relevant to present some verses of the Quran which gives us some ideas of science as we know today. And I quote. In chapter 36, which is called the Yasin, there's a passage which reads as follows. And the sun keeps revolving in its orbit as decreed by the Almighty and all-knowing God. And for the moon we have designated phases so it returns like the old dried curved date stalk. Neither can the sun overtake the moon, nor the night outspace the day. Each of them keeps coursing in its own orbits. But in chapter 55, entitled Ar-Rahman, which means the compassionate, we are reminded of God's creation and that which should admire and be grateful for. It is then asked in each case, which of these blessings of God you are going to deny. In this same chapter, we can read in verse 33 the following. O assembly of jinns and men, if you have the ability to cross the bounds of the heaven and earth, then do it. But you will never be able to cross them except with the authority of God. This was the passage of our holy book, which I quoted back in 69, when interviewed by the Radio Club Mozambique, and asked to comment on the arrival of man in the moon. I then said that the Quran had already admitted such an event, although its reading only in the present time with the advancement of science would lead us to read in this way, which was naturally not possible when the verses were revealed. As proven during the Middle Ages in the dark era of the old continent, it is from the coexistence of cultural tolerance which resulted ideas for progress of humanity. And let me here thank God for have given us the knowledge to enable us to overcome the difficulties which we are constantly faced with, and always with fear of Lord, with whom we will have to render account when we return to his presence on the day of judgment. Thus, we beg God to continue to enlighten men, to increase him in knowledge, but always being aware that this is only possible due to the generosity of God, who puts at our disposal its treasure of wisdom. And we should be aware of his infinite wisdom, and he always is grateful to the Creator. For all believers and not believers, may God have compassion for all of us, as it is said in the Quran, for believers and non-believers, the bounties of God will not be denied to anyone. Thank you very much. May peace of God be with you all. Shabbat shalom, Pasuk Gisum, and Walaikum Salam.